questions.
Hey everybody. Thank you very much as we continue the session today. I wanted to talk about two things. One is we talked about the youngsters from Morehouse. There are also students here from UGA, Kennesaw, Clark Atlanta, maybe other schools. Give us a quick stand up so we can see you here. Hello. Wanted to flag, you heard Peter talk about the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. Outside there are some flyers where you can join the First Amendment Foundation and continue our work like this, making a difference related to free speech, free expression, media access, government access. And if you can't find one of these outside, buttonhole me or Sean McIntosh, just give us a business card and we'll make sure you get an email. Let's start our session, Sex, Lies, and Hotel Receipts, by introducing our panel. First of all, the Honorable Amy Totenberg from the United States District Judge for the Northern District of Georgia, right here in Atlanta. Before her appointment by President Obama, Judge Totenberg was in private practice here in Atlanta. Judge Totenberg will play herself in this scenario. Karen Lehto leads HR and General Administration for Hoshizaki America. She's had a long career in HR leadership, including at Rockwell Automation, Larson Jewell, Berkshire Hathaway, CNN, and Serta Simmons Bedding. In this hypothetical, Karen will be the HR rep for Biggles Aviation, Inc. Ellen Fitzsimmons is the Executive Vice President and General Counsel at SunTrust, where she's just settling in. She was kind enough to agree to this panel even before her email at SunTrust was up and running. It's very kind of her. She was before SunTrust at CSX Railroad. And in this hypothetical, Ellen will be the general counsel for Biggles Aviation. Ed Buckley is a partner with Buckley Beal LLP, where he specializes in employment law and civil rights cases. He was born and raised right here in Atlanta, went to Emory Law. And in this hypothetical, his very successful law practice will be transported to the metropolis of Lizard Lick, Georgia. Johnita Due is Vice President and Assistant General Counsel for CNN. She specializes in content, media access, and diversity issues. As a professional partner at CNN, I can assure you she saved me from embarrassment more times than I can count. In this scenario, Johnita will be the content lawyer for the Frog TV group of television stations, which includes WFRG, the television station in beautiful Lizard Lick. And Mike Petchenik is the North Fulton Bureau Chief for WSB-TV Channel 2, where he's been the last 9 years. He's worked in Louisville and Augusta, and like me, he started his journalism career as news director of his college radio station. Mike will be working in this scenario as a reporter for WFRG, the number one station in the market. So a little bit of legal fine print here. This is mostly imaginary. Any similarity to real names or locations is purely coincidental. And key here is that the individuals portraying the characters in the presentation are friends and neighbors who agreed to do this out of support for the foundation. They have not perpetrated, nor have they been victims of harassment as described in the hypothetical. So our story is set in Lizard Lick, the seat of Frog County. The town has grown quite a bit since last we visited, led by an influx of high-tech jobs attracted by the town's entrepreneurial culture. One larger-than-life figure here is Jim Bigglesworth, Biggles to his friends and admirers. He cuts a handsome and dashing figure in his trademark green flight suit. He was a Navy fighter pilot who returned to Georgia Tech to get a PhD in electrical engineering, thus the power cord. He quickly built a reputation as having a mind that could bridge the theoretical and the practical. So immediately after graduation, he convinced some big-time Georgia investors to power up a high-efficiency solar power business, Biggles Power Systems. It was a big success. His solar panels doubled the efficiency of existing panels. It meant a lot of needed jobs in Frog County. He sold the business at a large profit to a Chinese outfit, but Biggles wanted bigger. He bought a small Georgia-based aircraft design firm and created Biggles Aviation. He began work on a solar-powered aircraft out of Lizard Lick International Airport, the ultimate goal, solar-powered freight aircraft. Making a long story short, Jim Bigglesworth became the first person to fly solo around the world in an aircraft powered by the sun. He left from Lizard Lick International. A month later, he landed back here, having demonstrated the solar systems he developed could power an aircraft around the globe. The landing was covered live on, I think we had the reporters and the executives here from CNN, Fox, the New York Times, the AJC, and even the Eternal Word television network. It was a big deal. Biggles was the toast of Lizard Lick. His company's stock soared. Already wealthy, he'd almost become a billionaire. But now he's also internationally famous. And the orders for the high efficiency solar-powered freight aircraft were pouring in. He's well-respected around Lizard Lick. He's a deacon at the First Presby Baptist Episcopalian Church at Lizard Lick, where he's chaired the finance committee. He's been a generous donor to numerous charities, including the Bring Back the Frogs environmental group. Things have been going great. There's only one problem. One of the women who worked on the design team asked for an appointment with the Biggles Aviation HR director, Karen Lehto. Karen, she's left a brief message on your voicemail asking for a meeting. The engineer wants advice from HR on how to deal with some personnel stuff. She doesn't want to use the corporate integrity whistleblower line because she worries about confidentiality. Her name is Susie Ann McSweeney. She's a 29-year-old Stanford Aeronautics grad who had also been a student athlete, swimmer, and diver who went to nationals. Karen, do you agree to take a meeting with her?
Absolutely.
So how do you prepare for that meeting?
Typically, what an HR person, and probably a more grizzled and senior HR person would do, is not immediately go to the personnel file to get the scoop on.
2017 was a year we saw the truth, objective, empirical, evidence-based truth, more battered and abused than at any time in the history of our country.
That's plain.
We saw the White House enshrined by proven facts.
We have unplugged Jeff Flake. Don't tell him.
So to answer your question, Richard, typically I take the meeting cold, so as not to bias myself against Suzanne in any way, and hear what she has to say. So you engage in some initial conversation to calm the employee down, because typically when they come under that pretense, you know there's something wrong. Probably the HR person who is keenly aware of the power structure within the company has some idea of what the problem could be and may speculate, but you try to keep that to the side and just listen. In the case of a younger female employee, you would obviously be concerned about harassment, pay, or other, you know, kind of treatment-related issues. But other than that, you're going to listen to Suzanne. And so I would engage Suzanne in some idle chatter, ask her about her experience.
Let's not get quite so far ahead. So
you've prepared for the meeting? I have prepared nothing.
So you've not even called down to her department to figure out
Yes. No, I won't do that. I will just take the meeting.
Okay. Yeah. So the word around the company is that she's got, there's lots of kudos on her, right? She's won two design awards, including for a huge patented breakthrough in bonding solar panels to curved wing surfaces. A couple of colleagues warn, you know, the gossip on her is she's still learning the world of corporate politics and be a bit naive from time to time. One of the department secretaries you know well, you've heard scuttlebutt that she dated one of the other engineers in the department last year. Didn't work out, things got a tad tense for a few weeks, but then calmed down. So where do you hold the meeting? Is anybody else present?
Typically no, and we would hold the meeting in the HR function unless Susie Ann was uncomfortable. We would give her the option to meet off-site or for lunch, depending on the nature of the confidential concern she had, especially given the fact that she's indicated she does not want to call into the confidential integrity line or the call-in line, which is not unusual that employees would be reticent to use that line.
So, do you take notes?
Yes, copious notes.
Really?
Very copious notes.
Ellen, are you happy about that?
Yes.
Okay, good notes.
She's got to get it right.
So Susie Ann McSweeney claims that Biggles had repeatedly touched her inappropriately during meetings, rubbing her knee underneath the table. She had privately asked him to stop, she said, but the unwanted attention continued. Then went on a business trip to Huntsville, Alabama. She said he showed up at her hotel room pushing his way inside, telling her if she wanted to get ahead, he needed for her to make him happy. If she was happy, she could get to run the entire wing panel design group. And at this point, Karen, Susie Ann bursts into tears and describes how afraid she would lose her career, she slept with him. And now, she says, Biggles keeps suggesting more encounters, and she says, she said, no. Last week, without warning, she was taken off leadership of the cutting edge wing panel design group and reassigned to the engine development group. Same pay, lateral move, but not where she wanted to be. And that morning at the company cafeteria, she said she happened to pass Biggles, who had just bought coffee with her former boyfriend from the wing panel design group. She plucked up the courage and asked him pointedly why she was reassigned. Young lady, here at Biggles Aviation, we expect our employees to be all in. We hope that you can be developed further in the engine development group and learn the bigger picture about our business. What do you advise, Susie Ann, Karen?
Well, at this point in time, my beavers are up as an HR person, obviously given the disclosure that Susie's just made to me, and I'm highly conscious of not only the risk for Susie, but the risk to the business. And I have learned, like most HR folks, that you can't take every word at face value, but reading her emotions, reading her fear, I'm gonna try to console her, have her clarify some of her facts, take some notes, and ask who else she's spoken with, because often they will. So I try to find out who else she's told the story to. I will ask her to take some notes herself and ask her if she'd be willing to offer a written statement to me.
So is your primary responsibility here as HR director to the company, or to make sure the employees are properly treated? To Jim Bigglesworth, he is, after all, the brand and the brains behind this company, right?
Correct. So HR folks have to do both, and that's a hard thing for people who may not be as emotionally mature in this function. And we have to carry the weight of both. But ultimately, when it comes down to it, compliance, the law, and look out for our employees is probably the number one goal of HR.
So do you review her personnel file?
I will at that point in time. I will investigate. I will probably informally, without leading on any awareness of any issue elsewhere in the organization, I may have informal discussions just trying to find out what's going on in that department and get some peripheral information for me to understand how to navigate the corporate power structure. Because HR is typically keenly aware of the politics of power.
We're going to get back to that.
Okay, so we're going to be careful. So we are going to do our own slight investigation to get some more facts, because we know our next stop is the GC, and
okay.
they're going to ask
so
us questions.
Let's pause there. So the file, the personnel file, full of kudos.
Correct.
Annual reviews, bosses talked about her strong work ethic, support for her team, maxed her annual bonuses every year since she joined the company. You've taken lots of notes. When do you take the allegations to the legal department?
After I've completed what I feel is a satisfactory review of what I anticipate our legal counsel will ask
us. Do you do it verbally, or do you write a detailed memo?
I will not write a detailed memo at that point. That would be, I would get in trouble with the GC for writing a memo.
How much trouble would she get in if she wrote a detailed memo?
We've changed our policies on that. So no, I think we live in a world where we'd rather get it right. And so when you create a lot of drama around the paper and the records retention, you constrain the investigation. What you want is a full investigation where people feel like you're about the objectives rather than fencing liability. We feel like if we work on the ethical issues and that the litigation is the tail and the company's behavior, which is sound and fulsome, is the dog, and that will control the outcome.
So as general counsel of Biggles Aviation, is this the right moment for you to hear about this? Or would you have liked to know about it in the first moment this got flagged?
Because of who it is, a CEO and the board, we would typically want to hear about it instantly, because this is a public company, as you said, his stock price has gone up. So there's a public company board that would expect an allegation of wrongdoing against the CEO to be escalated instantly and actually investigated externally.
So you are worried about this as a potential liability big time. Stockholders, the employees of the company, potentially.
Right, but even if it were a small thing, I think a lot of companies have just said, rather than subject yourself to the second guessing on whether you suppressed information about CEO wrongdoing, you go to your audit committee chair and you say, we have an allegation and we're going to handle it professionally, but we wanted you to know in real time that we're looking at this. And we typically, on things, most, as you all know, public companies have escalation policies, and for an allegation of wrongdoing involving the CEO, we would try to make sure that we had taken it outside and shared it with the board within a matter of hours.
Aren't you worried about it leaking if you're taking it to the board?
If we do, they shouldn't be on the board. We've got bigger problems than leaks.
So do you talk to Biggles Work?
No. Not. I mean, I think we'd talk to the audit committee chair and tell them that we were going to.
So at what point do you go to Biggles Work?
Well, we would probably let the Bigglesworth know that we were having a conversation about an allegation of wrongdoing, but not the specifics.
Hey, is that Susie Ann thing?
We're having an investigation about an allegation of wrongdoing, and we can assure
Look, it was consensual. I saw Susie Ann McSweeney at the hotel bar, right? He says, look, finished a bottle and a half of white wine together, and she suggested that we go upstairs to her hotel room to finish the remaining bottle. I got the bartender.
Thanks for sharing.
I am sure Trixie, the bartender, would remember us. She was very friendly. And she's probably complained about what I said in the cafeteria too, hasn't she?
Jim, we have an allegation of wrongdoing with respect to the CEO, and it will be investigated independently, fairly, and promptly. And the
so how do you investigate this?
We take that external.
So you hire somebody to come from the outside?
Right. So if we had an allegation that the CEO had not paid his parking bill for 6 months, we would handle that internally. But on something of this sensitivity, given particularly the environment, we would, if the lawyer's job is to represent the company, what the company needs more than anything is to treat everyone fairly. And there's almost no scenario in which handling that entirely internally, that will have credibility.
So the external firm comes back and says, look, this is pretty nuanced. Both of them.
Haven't you had a chance to talk to them yet? They haven't. They need to.
They talked to. Right. They talked to Bigglesworth. They talked to Susie Ann.
Right.
They've both heard basically what you've heard to this point.
Okay.
And the external folks say, you know, this is pretty nuanced.
Okay.
What's difficult is that she was reassigned.
So then we would look at whether it was a practice. I would talk to my colleague in HR and find out whether rotations of people like her was typical and whether it was truly a developmental rotation or whether it was a shotgun fired in the middle of the night.
Karen, what do you think? It feels to me like that might be legitimate, right?
A company with good, strong practices, the HR team would have known about the movement of Susie Ann, but in all reality, many times those movements happen and we find out about it after the fact, particularly when you have a very dominant CEO who's very popular. So we may have not known about Susie Ann's move.
So let's just say for the purposes of this scenario, it kind of fits with the company process. It's not too far out of the ordinary. How do you tell Susie Ann, look, this is pretty nuanced here, that reassignment is pretty normal within the company, you know? Jimmy did it a few months ago, Kathy did it and went down to the landing gear group, several other folks have moved around, all of them really talented. How do you then tell her that and tell her, basically get her to chill here and know that actions have consequences?
I'm actually more interested in my conversations with Jim, and I bet Karen is too. Whether or not it was consensual, she was in his line of supervision, which violates almost every company's policy on.
So would you consider punishing him in some way, taking away some of his stock options?
Absolutely.
So basically,
but that's not for me to decide. That's for the board to decide.
Okay.
Based on Karen's recommendation.
So
actually, usually HR is out of it at this point.
No, you're a powerful figure here at Miggles.
As she has been in many places, let me tell you. So Susie Ann isn't really happy with what she's heard from the company. A friend urges her to go find an attorney to get advice. So she lets her fingers do the walking through the lizard lick yellow pages, where she finds a very large ad for Ed Buckley's law firm in color.
Now I know this is fantasy.
She calls Ed and asks for an appointment. How do you evaluate her case?
I would talk with her for as long as she appeared to on the phone first, and then with an understanding that she would come in and we would meet. I would ask her to prepare a detailed timeline with every word, anything at all in there that she felt constituted any wrongdoing on the part of
Including Bigfoot. Emails that she got?
Emails, text messages.
Now, she's working in a firm that's doing a bunch of classified stuff.
Right.
Are you going to be concerned about classified emails getting outside the company here?
we'll argue about that in discovery, right?
I don't think an email that says meet me at the Chapman Rest Hotel is a classified email.
But, and I don't think we're going to argue that
it is. And I'm not interested particularly in truly classified information. What I'm interested in is what happened and when and who she talked to. I want to know everything that happened in her discussion with HR as well as her discussions with Bigglesworth. So I'm going to get as much detail as I can from her. I'll ask her to send it to me in advance of the meeting if she can, and then sit down with her and go further into depth so I have a really detailed understanding of what happened.
Now, are you going to ask her whether her company requires arbitration to settle disputes for the organization?
That is part of the discussion, but it's
good,
not going to
because
be, yeah. Because guess what? There's an arbitration clause.
Turns out on the day she was hired 3 years earlier, among the company policies she read and agreed to was an arbitration agreement for any disputes between the company
right.
and the employee. That agreement calls for the costs of arbitration to be split between the employer and the employee. The outcome of any arbitration is deemed to be a private matter. Does the arbitration clause mean the case is a non-starter for you?
It does not. And it does not for a couple of reasons. First of all, I would scour that arbitration clause to see if it is going to hold up under the law. If it puts an unfair financial burden on her, I very well may challenge it. And as far as I'm concerned in my communications with the company, I'd make that clear. It's not a non-starter at all.
So what are the downsides of arbitration if you are the plaintiff's attorney and plaintiff?
If indeed the matter is put in arbitration, my concern is always that most of the arbitration organizations that you choose from are front-loaded with management lawyers who do arbitration, and so I'm concerned about a defense verdict or a conservative verdict. I think statistically there are more verdicts for plaintiffs or claimants in arbitration than perhaps there are in, say, federal district court, but that's for a couple of reasons. One, we typically get past summary judgment because the arbitrator wants to earn a fee trying the case, and two, excuse me for being cynical, but the arbitrator wants to be selected again by defense counsel, so while they might find a plaintiff's verdict, they won't necessarily render a shock verdict. So I think those are my general concerns. The other concerns is under some of these arbitration companies, you have limited discovery. You have so many witnesses you can depose, maybe three or less sometimes. You have to really fight to get more witnesses to depose. And in a case like this, you know, I want to know if there are any Me Too witnesses, any other witnesses who have been subjected to similar conduct by Mr. Bigglesworth. So I want to do broad sweeping discovery, and under a lot of these arbitration companies want to limit you. Confidentiality is another concern, because if I file a lawsuit, that's the best way for me to find out if there's anybody out there that's had a similar experience. Because if I file a lawsuit and it goes public, if there are other women who have had the same experience, I'm as likely as not, and may well get a phone call. Yep, it happened to me too. And then I want to talk to that person. I want to talk to that person as a potential witness in the case. Those are some of the concerns. The other is if my client has to pay half the arbitration fee, it could bankrupt him. And that's probably the first place I would challenge this thing.
Ellen Fitzsimmons, I know you've only been in Beatles Aviation a short time, but why did they put the arbitration policy in place at Beatles Aviation? And what are the upsides, and what are the downsides from a corporate perspective?
So an upside, it is faster and private, and sometimes the employee wants privacy. You can make an argument that one of the things that will give people the willingness to come forward is if they feel comfortable that it's a, that it's more of a private resolution. So I understand that it's vulnerable, and that'll be a conversation that we're going to have. I would also say that one of the things that, you know, when we talked before, we talked about what we did with Jim. We were less specific with what we did with the employee, and I think that there are a suite of things that you could do. You could actually, suppose we had restored her to her prior position, say, okay, we did a rotation, you don't like it, back you go. Actually, that gets into a very complicated set of facts. Second, if we've cut his pay, we've got a series of disclosure issues in terms of, you know, SEC and other issues of warning. So frankly, the arbitration agreement's the least of my worry.
Okay. Ed, are you concerned about Jim Bigglesworth's bar receipt and his account that the friendly drink at the bar undermines your client's credibility?
First of all, I'm concerned they were drinking white wine.
it was rainy Chardonnay. Yeah. $60 a bottle.
No, I'm not deeply concerned about that. I think that intoxication, it sounds like both parties may have been somewhat intoxicated, but that does not create consent. Intoxication does not equal consent. And more than that, let's assume, quote, consent. The question here really is the conduct unwelcome? That's the question under federal law anyway. Was Bigglesworth's conduct unwelcome? And if it was, if she's saying, no, I really don't want to do this, and he says, well, if you want to get ahead in the company, you got to cooperate, then that's unwelcome. And that's what I'm going to be focusing on.
What are the challenges to getting an arbitration case moved from arbitration to in front of a federal judge?
Well, the first question in my mind is, do I file a case first in federal court or state court, if as the case may be? And there's a real question about which way I would go here, because I have state tort, assault, battery, intentional infliction of emotional distress, on and on. And so do I file it in state court? And then the company challenges me and moves to have the matter moved to arbitration, and then we litigate that question in court. So my starting place is, can I file this? Do I have a good faith basis to file this in state or federal court, depending on which way I decide to go? And if the answer is yes, I'm going to start there, and I'm going to let them try to drag me into arbitration.
Judge Totenberg, are there circumstances where the decision to move the matter from arbitration to your court is ever easy?
Well, sometimes it's easy. I mean, sometimes things are very straightforward, and because simply the individual clearly has consented to arbitration, and the Supreme Court authority is so absolutely well established at this point. In ways that I find surprising at times personally, but that's what the law is, and so that's, you know, what we have to enforce. And a lot of those cases simply do go forward and immediately get removed. Now, if there's a real question as to consent, or some of the questions that Ed has raised, then you can start. There'll be some litigation about that. And I have, I would say, a whole subspecies of cases in front of me here, which are. Where everyone's litigating about do we arbitrate or not? I mean, it's just sort of all about the form. And a lot of these are employment cases, but a lot of them are consumer cases. The employment cases, though, certainly are the dominant ones. And it's just can take a long time, frankly, to ferret out, because it's very bitter sometimes.
I want to ask the panel about a bipartisan bill that New York Democratic Senator Kirsten Gillibrand and Lindsey Graham of South Carolina has entered in, that would end the practice of secret arbitration and sexual harassment cases. The bill is now in committee. The attorneys general of all 50 states and the District of Columbia have endorsed it. Interestingly, if this passes, it would actually reverse GOP legislation from last year signed by President Trump that blocked Obama-era regulations that prohibited government contractors from keeping sexual harassment cases secret. Would this be a game changer, Ellen?
Yes.
Is this a bill that might not be good for Biggles Aviation, but might be good for the country?
So I don't know. I don't know enough about the bill to comment on it as a matter of public policy. I think it's a game changer, not really because of sexual harassment, but because what it pretends for consumer arbitration and a suite of other activities. So we're at Biggles, we care about arbitration more broadly than sexual harassment. I mean, if the events of the last year have taught people anything, it should be that you've got to deal with this stuff in real time. And I might point out that this, I think you made this scenario up before Steve Wynn was arrived at center stage. So we don't have a corporate interest in clenching and suppressing this kind of behavior. If you want your company to thrive over the long term, you don't keep people like this in chairs, but you make sure they're afforded due process. So I don't find arbitration necessarily inconsistent with due process, but this doesn't trouble me in sexual harassment, it troubles me more broadly.
And Buckley, isn't this your Full Employment Act?
Well, I'm fully employed anyway, but, you know.
And I can testify to that.
I think the first question, this bill is in committee. I believe that it's going to have a veto-proof majority to become law. I don't think this president is going to sign this bill. If that happened, I don't think it would be a particular game changer for me. It's, you know, if I have to arbitrate a sexual harassment case, I'll arbitrate a sexual harassment case.
Judge Totenberg, would you and your colleagues now have a bunch of additional work if arbitration was done away with in sexual harassment cases? Can you imagine your weekends now?
I have already invaded weekends, I think. But I don't know that it would make that much difference. I can't really fully explain in some ways how much time is spent resolving disputes about whether this case is going to go to arbitration or not. And it's a fact-intensive business, and there are times when you really end up having to have a trial on that very issue. Was there consent? Was it? Was this signing off on, you know, when you go to the doctor's office these days, you sign off electronically on your consents, and you don't really see the whole document, and there gets to be, and of course, as the employment process has become more digitized, and it already was digitized, but even more so, people are signing off on all sorts of screens, and there can be lots of disputes about these issues of what they have actually signed off on, and was it the human resources officer who signed off on their behalf? And so it really is a troubling area, and I don't believe that they. If I could get rid of some of these cases and just simply, we're going to go to trial, we're going to go to summary judgment, what's going to happen rather than litigating about arbitration, I think it would be an enormous positive step forward.
So that's a great cue and setup, because we're going to do away with arbitration agreement in this case. We're going to rewind. Ed Buckley, let's reevaluate Suzanne's case without arbitration. Could a lateral transfer be considered retaliation under current law? Is this a contingency case, or is she paying you up front?
It's a contingency case, and a lateral transfer certainly can be considered an adverse employment action, particularly where Bigglesworth had promised her as part of the sexual harassment that she would get ahead in her job, that she would see advancement and promotion. Suddenly, she's being lateraled over to another department when her expertise and everything else was in this department. So I don't think it's too problematic at all that this is an adverse action. And I would take this case on a contingency basis.
So she's telling you, look, I know I didn't get a pay cut. This is not what I want to do. I'm feeling punished for not putting out.
And she has a claim for compensatory damages for emotional distress. She has a claim potentially for punitive damages in this situation.
So will you have a conversation with the defendants here before you file suit? Will you call up?
I would.
Now, Ellen, are you representing the company or are you representing Bigglesworth too?
You always represent the company.
So as general counsel, even though he owns majority shares in this organization, anything, so tell me who you think the defendants would be, Ed. Who are we going to drag into this?
I think Bigglesworth would be, I think the company would be, Bigglesworth would be an individual defendant for purposes of any tort claims that might exist, such as assault, battery, intentional infliction of emotional distress. It's actually a tort in Georgia, which most people don't know about, just sexual harassment. It's just a Prosser type duty breach causation damage. It's a tort. I always get challenged on that, but it exists and it's in the books. So I would have tort claims against him. I would have potentially Title VII claims against the company, and I may also have claims for negligent retention of Bigglesworth, depending on how discovery played out and whether the company was on notice that this fellow had a problem with this sort of behavior.
So do you just file it, or do you have a conversation with Ellen first? How does that work?
The first thing I would do before I even have, I might call Ellen up and say, I'm sending you a letter. And then I would send a detailed letter that breaks down everything that's happened. I would attach an EEOC charge, either in draft form or one that had been filed, that explains what has happened. I would attach a draft lawsuit and say, this is what we intend to file. The thing about the EEOC charge is, if I file it, the EEOC is still confidential. Of course, if somebody at the company decided to broadcast it, I can't control that. But I would send a demand letter, a written demand, asking for relief, and give them basically everything I plan to file in advance so they can evaluate.
Karen and Ellen, Jim Bigglesworth is very angry. Says you, each of you, have failed to protect him. He tells you both in no uncertain terms, he signs the paychecks around here, and from his perspective, you are not performing, not performing. Ellen, does that put pressure on you to make this case go away?
No. Again, I know I sound like I don't take this seriously, but I think one of the things that corporate crisis has baked every in-house counsel in is the knowledge that there's a difference between being unemployed and unemployable. And so if Jim Bigglesworth turns out to be Matt Lauer or Steve Wynn, I'm unemployable. So if he fires me, I'm unemployed, but I can find something else to do. If I've sat on Matt Lauer's record for a decade, I'm unemployable. And in fact, in the media space, I think there's somebody, a general counsel at Fox News, who's being evaluated for whether she sat and watched a lot of these types of claims come across the screen. And I think she's pretty vulnerable right now. So, and I'm not trying to be smug about it, but remember here too, we've had an internal investigation, and the internal investigation by, we'll call it Bones Bay law firm in Atlanta. Excellent. And we said we want to know if this is a one-off argument about consent, or if there are other indicia of this as a pattern. And when they came back, and all we did was all the board chose to do was cut his pay for a violation, a great impropriety. But if you have to, in dealing with this scenario, assume you had an internal investigation of integrity by professionals and it only found this one thing. If we got out of bed after our internal investigation with this gifted law firm and found we had Matt Lauer, we don't have it, he's gone.
Yeah, but so is $2 billion worth of company stock, right?
And they said Wynn wouldn't survive, and it did. And they said that the Today Show wouldn't survive, and it did. Ultimately, you have a suite of commitments to your board and to the public that you have to live into. And so we're going to face a host of shareholder lawsuits for failing to have determined earlier that there was a pattern. That's more lethal than anything that our talented young engineer has to offer. But you have to decide whether, whether you're going to live into your commitments or not. And it's a lot more expensive to not, in my opinion.
So I'm now going to put Judge Totenberg in the hot seat. Based on the facts you've heard so far, presume it's presented, is it likely you'll see this case go to trial in your court? Do many sexual harassment cases actually get to trial? What happens to them?
Well, if it's a case involving, basically, this is sort of what's called quid pro quo harassment, where if you don't do X, I'm going to do Y to you. That's more straightforward for being able to get past summary judgment and for it to go to trial and then also to be resolved. It's extremely rare, really very extremely rare, to have a sexual harassment case go to trial that, because of the sensitivity of the issues, the explosiveness of the issues, and I think at that point people are going to settle if it gets past summary judgment. And a quid pro quo case like that is more likely to get passes. But, if you change the facts a little bit and you don't have any of the hotel incident occurring, and it's just that he is feeling up her knee and doing this on an ongoing basis, you've got a whole other world. That, because of the standards for establishing hostile work environment claims, which is a lot also of what people have complained about and more recently on Me Too issues, and how people felt intimidated, it affected their work environment, and that it poisoned it, that's much more difficult. Those cases can get thrown out, and do get thrown out all the time. And then it's a little bit, I think there is a sort of disjunction in some ways in the way that people are perceiving at this juncture what the law is in this area, because it's really from a perspective of what most people think, that, well, that must be unlawful. And that must be an unlawful work condition that he continually is feeling up her knee and making comments about her appearance. But those sorts of cases under Supreme Court and 11th Circuit authority, and particularly 11th Circuit authority, on an ongoing basis, dismissed at summary judgment.
So now, what are the factors from the 11th Circuit that affects how these kinds of cases play out in Georgia?
It's the severity and the pervasiveness, and they're just, I really happen to think that this is going to change some. I think that, people's perceptions of what is severe and pervasive are going to change, and we talk about what an objective, reasonable person would think is basically acceptable in the workplace and would not affect them. That is a changing world, I think. But right now we're being bound by authority such as this. I just wanted to read this to sort of give you a sense of it. A panel of the 11th Circuit in one case said that the employer's conduct was not sufficiently severe or pervasive for the conduct, including telling the plaintiff one time that she was beautiful, frequently calling her at home over weekends and at 9:30 and 10 at night, staring at her twice, repeatedly asking her to lunch, touching her jewelry once, touching her knee once, unbuttoning his pants and tucking in his shirt in her presence once, and touching the hem of her dress once. In another case in Mendoza, a panel reached the same conclusion when presented with evidence that the employer told the plaintiff once, "I'm getting fired up," and on one occasion rubbed his hip against hers while touching her shoulder and smiling at her, once made sniffing noises while staring at her groin, once made sniffing noises without looking at her groin, and followed and stared at her constantly. And the court in Gupta said that the employer's conduct, while sometimes overly personal, was not sexually explicit or threatening. As the a person who has a lot of young women in her life, whether as daughters or as law clerks, I can say that's not the standard among young women any longer. And I think that that is going to, it's going to be pose a very interesting challenge in terms of where the law is going, because that's what you see cited again and again in cases. And it, frankly, it's the parallel of what's happened with racial hostile work environment cases too, of people saying things that you think in fact probably would make it extremely uncomfortable. But I think, and maybe I'm wrong, but many people and the way it's portrayed in the media think that that's already unlawful. It's certainly terrible practice. But that's what I just wanted to say. So what happens if there ends up being some problem in your case about what happened at the motel and whether it was really consensual? Does that poison the rest of her case? It's going to trial. It's going to get settled if the hotel goes on. What happens if it's just this other conduct? Is this a job-related transfer? We do it all the time. Then it gets a lot messier.
What factors do the lawyers not think about that they should think about when these cases come to trial?
Well, someone like Ed Buckley and his opponents think about a lot, so I'm not going to say I don't know what they don't think about. I think that they, and as I said, most of them don't go to trial, but Ed inherited a case of mine decades ago.
Has it been that long?
It has been that long, yes. And I think it was one of the first real trials involving sexual harassment of an employee, a 57-year-old woman at Norfolk Southern, and it was in front of, it was in Judge Murphy's court, Judge Murphy in up in Rome, and she was a very devout religious person, and this had been a radical experience to her, to be subjected to the advances of her boss that were highly sexual. And I won't go through all of what they were, but she's on the stand and her church is back there, her members of her church supporting her and going, yes. And as far as I can see, is because it was a terrible case to defend, I mean, to basically pursue as I did, facing a major law firm as I was representing the individual before Ed tried the case, is that no one believed anything. No one thought that she was a danger to them because she was 57 years old and it was not credible in their mind. And it's that, and I think all that's changed a lot. But they didn't believe it. And I think what happened when Ed tried the case was they were dealing with the flesh and blood reality of it and the way a jury would react to it. And I think that's, I have other cases that we have tried that are not sex cases, but what you really see is the way the lawyers have evaluated the case, and that's really is that they have diminished who the people are, and they have not really considered how they're going to communicate and appear, and they have really underestimated their power as human beings to communicate. And on the other side, of course, your client can end up being totally not credible, and there goes the case.
Over at WFRG is Mike Petchenik, the number one TV station in Metro Visiblick. You like to read court dockets for fun on the weekends. And you see mention of the name Jim Bigglesworth in the case Suzanne McSweeney versus Jim Bigglesworth. What's the first thing you do?
I pull the lawsuit off the pacer and look up the attorneys involved, reach out to Mr. Buckley, let him know that I'm interested in talking about the lawsuit. Obviously, read through the lawsuit, see what's in there, and then bring it.
You've got a lot of juicy stuff in this lawsuit so far.
Absolutely. I call my managing editor at midnight on a Saturday, wake him up out of bed, tell him what I got.
Ellen Fitzsimmons. Care to comment on behalf of Biggles Aviation?
No.
Are you writing that down?
What we and everyone else would do is make our statement about our values with respect to the treatment of our employees, and other than that, would not comment.
Ed Buckley, will you be talking to the media about this case, parading your plaintiff in front of the cameras, as we have seen in L.A.?
I think I probably wouldn't parade her in front of the cameras, because anything she says in the media may be read back to her in her deposition, so I'm not generally not inclined to do that. I would talk to the media about the case as pleaded, and I would in all likelihood make a request that any other victims of this sort of harassment please step forward so that we can hear from them. And that's one of the, for me, and I don't mean to sound like a cynic, but one of the values of the media is word gets out and other victims come forward. So that would be my primary thing, but I would comment on the pleadings. I would not comment on the evidence. We've got some bar rules that prevent us from doing that. And
that's not going to stop Mike from buttonholing you as you leave your office.
It won't. And I can comment really on anything that's filed in court up to a point. I don't think I can comment on credibility. I don't think I can comment on the criminal background of somebody, that sort of thing. There are some constraints on what I can say.
Mike, Bigglesworth has given a lot of campaign contributions over the years. Do you ask the Georgia congressman from the district around Lizard Lick, Talmadge Lowe? Ever heard of Talmadge Lowe? He chairs the Aviation Oversight Subcommittee in Congress. Do you call him up and ask him for comment?
Absolutely.
You know, I know Jim. I've known him for years, both as a close friend, as a personal advisor. He's kind and considerate towards all. Georgia needs more honest, principled people like Jim Bigglesworth, which is why I hope this cynical campaign to discredit his character ultimately fails.
That's ripped from the headlines.
You might use that?
I think so. I think it balances out.
So you also interviewed Donald Truman, a friend of Bigglesworth, who worked with Susie Ann McSweeney, who's willing to say on the record that in his opinion, Susie Ann is a money-grubbing slut. She needs to put her big boy pants on if she's going to work in a big boy industry. She was trying to get to the top by attempting to seduce the boss and then blaming him when she couldn't do her job.
Another rip from the headlines.
You think you could use that?
Just like capitalize.
Do you ask your in-house content lawyer to read the script before you go to air with this?
Absolutely.
Johnita Due, you are his in-house counsel.
Ideally, he'll have reached out to me even before, you know, scripting, but that's, you know, we'll see.
Anything you're worried about in any of these quotes?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the bigger question for me would be, you know, the simple story is reporting on the allegations in the lawsuit, right? And so, you know, do we want this just to be a news of the day story, or do we want to spend a little bit of time investigating to see what else is out there, and finding those other potential victims of Bigglesworth. But if we want to go for like the news of the day and just sort of report on the litigation, Tim Mulch's.
Can't you do both?
Yeah, you can do both. We can sort of just start and then continue with our investigating. We're not going to potentially defame Susie Ann McSweeney with Donald Truman's quote. I mean, we're going to have to, you know, of course, do some investigating and substantiation and see her response.
But at this point, is Suzanne a public figure, given the fact that this is a claim against a big name corporate type?
It depends on her
limited purpose.
It depends on her media strategy. It sounds like Ed has really tried to contain her a little bit from sort of, you know, parading out in the media. I don't like the term victims, but these accusers really are in a very tough situation. Because on the one hand, They want to tell their stories, and there's strength in numbers, and it really does encourage others to come forward. The moment they do sort of utilize the media in that manner, then they are potentially limited purpose public figures, and then it makes it easier for the accused to, you know, to say whatever they want about them to try to discredit their reputations. Now, if she simply, you know, filed a lawsuit, I mean, that wouldn't, you know, that wouldn't automatically make her a public figure. And so I would be very concerned about including any quote that calls her a slut, you know, regardless of whether, can we argue whether that's opinion or not. I mean, we'd have to sort of, you know, do some more investigating and check into it and see if, you know, there's any way to substantiate that that was part of her strategy to get ahead, you know, to be courted and sort of harassed, potentially allegedly harassed by Bigglesworth.
Judge Totenberg, do you have a view on limited purpose public figure status in cases like this? Should defendants and their friends be able to take pot shots at plaintiffs in harassment cases without having to worry about libel claims?
Well, I don't know that I have a view. I'm aware of the First Circuit's decision affirming a district court decision that dealt with a woman who came out and sued based on the allegations made. She said she was a victim of Bill Cosby, and counsel for, I guess, for Bill Cosby wrote back and had his letter published, and basically the court said she it had injected herself into something that was clearly a public scenario, knew that she was doing that, and became a limited public figure. So. It was something, frankly, I hadn't thought that much about, though I can understand in terms of the values of a free press why that does potentially make sense. And so I think it's something, a whole other level of concerns that Ed Buckley and other plaintiffs' counsel have to be concerned, themselves concerned about if they put their clients out there or they bring defamation claims, and it's something obviously that the media's counsel has to be concerned about too. But it frankly, it's nothing that has come to me. I guess, you know, you could say this is one of the virtues for arbitration is that you're going to get to sort some of this out privately, though people can still use the media. It's not usually the confidentiality doesn't bar them from being out there, but the results are not public in the same way. And there's not an occasion because of every motion filed to be able to go out and publicize. I just want to say just about one thing about the arbitration. You've asked about these issues, and I want to say that I served as an arbitrator. I understand many of the virtues of arbitration, but I think also as a, basically as a judge and as a loyal lover of transparency and the First Amendment, I also think that there is an enormous, we should all be concerned about having these issues transparently presented in our courts that are accessible to the entire public and to the media. But when there is genuine consent between people, which there's also often not in the arbitration forum, but when there really is and they all feel this is the best way to get something resolved, I mean, I think that makes complete sense.
All right, so Mike Petchenik, you've been typing away down there. Ring, 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 ring. This is your editor. I need to see that script. Has the lawyer signed off on it yet?
I'm going to show it to her right now, actually.
Do you want to read it out and see how she feels about it?
Okay. Things are not so sunny for solar-powered aircraft inventor and international He's facing complaints about slimy behavior in Lizard Lake and beyond. In a lawsuit we obtained, a 29-year-old subordinate engineer claims Bigglesworth made inappropriate advances towards her and forced her to sleep with him in exchange for upward movement at his company, Biggles Aviation. In an exclusive interview, Susie Ann McSweeney's attorney Ed Buckley told WFRG-TV, when she rebuffed his advances, he reassigned her to another division of the company, telling her, quote, I expect our employees to be all in. Buckley asked for other potential victims to come out. In a statement, Biggles Aviation spokesman told us, WFRG-TV, that the Navy veteran and church volunteer had no comment, but pointed to the company's values and respect for women in the workplace. In court documents we obtained, Biggles maintained the relationship was consensual, claiming he had the receipt to prove they had met for a nightcap. However, a bartender we interviewed told us she saw a very drunk pair drinking wine and that Bigglesworth appeared to be forcing himself upon what appeared to be a very uncomfortable McSweeney. Biggles' close friend, Congressman Talmadge Lowe, says he's a kind and considerable man and calls this a cynical campaign to discredit Biggles, and another friend, Donald Truman, called McSweeney, quote, a money-grubbing slut who attempted to seduce her boss, only blaming him because she couldn't do her job. Ed Buckley, however, called both of those claims hogwash and fake news. Stockholders are now putting pressure on Biggles to resign and seek treatment at a sex addiction.
Sure, you're getting a little sure, yeah. Johnita, anything in there that concerning maybe the slut line? Anything else that's of concern?
I mean, listen.
By the way, kudos on writing that this fast. He did not know this scenario.
Yeah, I mean, the tone was a little sensationalistic. But
this is Frog County. You've got to get the ratings.
The allegations seem to track the allegations in the complaint. As I said, I'm concerned about, you know, the Truman line. I do think that we did seek the response of Susie's attorney. I don't know if we did any of our own sort of investigating in terms of talking to other, you know, potential people.
I reached out to the boyfriend you mentioned.
I think you got to Trixie, right?
The bartender, too. The boyfriend didn't have anything of consequence to say, so we didn't.
Okay, so she hadn't shared any of the allegations.
All right, I'm going to keep it moving along because we're running very low, and I got a lot of pages to skip here, I think. Ellen Fitzsimmons, the morning after the story runs, the stock price crashes down $6 a share, about 10%. What's going on inside Biggles Aviation? Does the board call another meeting?
Yes.
Is there pressure from the board on Biggles to settle this case, make it go away?
Yes.
Karen Lehto, the morning after the story runs, what do you find when you come into the office and check your voicemail?
I find a return call from my lawyer.
You also have messages from another engineer, Lavender Bunch.
Oh.
Yeah. Okay. From the landing gear group, wanting to talk about what Jim Bigglesworth did to her. And I'm going to skip through this really fast. Employees don't trust her on an performance improvement plan already because she can't meet deadlines. She's had a couple of pretty big screw-ups, cost the company a lot of money. We're going to presume the same drill that you would process through, correct? She couldn't remember the specific day. Says she was at a space aviation conference in Orlando, staying at the Holiday Inn when Bigglesworth repeatedly touched her inappropriately at the hotel bar. She said she got drunk, tried to kiss her. He tried to kiss her several times, and his hands wandered where they weren't. You were at the same conference, knew that Bigglesworth didn't touch a drop all week because he had a lot of presentations to make and that he wasn't staying at the Holiday Inn. So when do you bring in Ellen on this case?
You're saying I do not believe this person.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, I would bring her in immediately then as an obligation in my role and function.
Okay, so
my next step would be to Ellen.
So how do you handle the second claim?
We're going right back to Bones, May.
Okay. Karen, while you're managing all of this, that afternoon you get an email from the department head notifying you that Lavender Bunch is being terminated. A test rig wasn't calibrated right, and during the test the structure collapsed, destroying the prototype gear and the test stand. It was a $250,000 mistake. A boss, longtime friend of Bigglesworth, said he'd had it with her mistakes and let her go for cause, told her to get out of the building right now. Are you surprised by this?
I would be very upset because he violated our policy that we need to go through HR first before you terminate somebody. So had he done this without any guidance or counsel from HR, who would then seek the counsel of our legal team, he would have been outside policy and under scrutiny for his actions, regardless of the believability of anyone's complaints. He has an obligation to go through our function first.
Basically, you're agreeing with Karen on this
100%.
One. Okay, so Ed Buckley, Lavender Bunch has just called you to say she was fired the afternoon after talking to HR about sexual harassment by Jim Bigglesworth. Sound like a good case?
I'd want to go through the same process. I'd want to interview her in depth. I would want to know about any performance-related problems. I'd want to know about the validity of her being accused of causing the collapse of this prototype. I'd want documentation, including performance reviews. I'd want to know what the causal connection was between her boss, who is a friend of Bigglesworth, firing her, and her report of sexual harassment. If I can establish or believe I can establish a causal link, then I may. But the other concern I have is she is potentially a corroborating witness in my case in chief, and I may not want to have her as a client so that we don't get into a cross-examination of her. Well, you're represented by everybody, and you're represented by everybody, and you're right. You know, I think it's cleaner if I just represent the one client, so I may refer to somebody else.
Okay, so we've got to do an ethics component to this so you can get your ethics hours, everybody of the lawyers. So we now have a problem. Remember that, Mike Petchenik, remember that paralegal you talked to when you called Ed Buckley's office for comment 2 days ago?
Right.
You just got a call from her asking to meet over coffee at the Frog County Diner. I've got something that will help your story. Do you go?
Yes.
The paralegal says she used to be at a paralegal at Biggles Power Systems, but got sickened by what she saw there and quit. She asks for your notebook, writes the names of three women and dollar amounts, all at or pushing $300,000. She says these are all former employees of Biggles Power Systems who said they were sexually harassed by Jim Bigglesworth. Each reached sealed settlements after arbitration. She says she believes the three women still live around Lizard Lick. None of the women are clients of her current firm. You have a story supposed to turn on Bigglesworth case this week. You're going to try to get the names for second piece. You're going to try to get the names for this piece?
Absolutely.
How would you do that?
Well, she gave me the names, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you just go with that?
Well, no, I would certainly go look these women up. Reach out to them, ask them about their situations, and then go from there.
Janita, are you concerned that this leak breaks the secrecy of sealed settlements?
Well, listen, I mean, that's talking about game-changing policy. This idea of non-disclosure agreements and settlements relating to sexual harassment and assault cases, I mean, it needs to change because it really does prevent victims from being able to share their stories and from reporters from being able to report on them. But I'm not concerned about our violating any NDAs. You know, if the women want to talk to us, fine. We're not sort of unduly pressuring them. We're not tortiously interfering with their agreements. And I'd say go for it. Try and develop the trust with those sources and see what we can get.
So, Ellen, I know you didn't represent Biggles Power Systems, but speaking as an expert on non-disclosure agreements, you've probably handled a few in your time. Would these women be in trouble? What kind of trouble would the women be in if they talked to Petchenik in the current culture?
Right, so this is the legal versus practical,
yes,
problem. In an environment like this, there might be companies who would make it their priority to pursue these women for non-disclosure agreement violations. I don't think that would be our priority. Our priority right now, if these women are credible, is to fire Bones May and sue them for malpractice and failing to have identified these women in their investigation.
Oh, Judge Totenberg, you're going to be so busy.
I've got a lot of good clerks out there.
Mike, you reach out to one of these women, she gives you another name, so you've now got four additional names. Judge Totenberg, are you concerned about leaks of sealed settlements from one of the law firms? This appears to be coming from one of the law firms. Is that a concern, or is it all fair?
I can't say it's all fair, but that's really up to the parties to basically bring it to me. And if they're saying that they're, and if it's a sealed agreement that was entered into pursuant to, with the authority of the court in some way, then they can come back and say you breached the settlement agreement. But if not, this is really their business to pursue in terms of they can bring a, they might be bringing a lawsuit in Superior Court. But this is a private contractual matter at that point. And you know, it might at some point become, you know, in the area of Fair Labor Standards, which is an old New Deal statute. They we require the parties to file the settlement on the docket. And for a long time, many judges accepted them just not being filed, but just being sent to them for review. A number of us said, we want to have it filed on the docket. And then it's just a culture change again. And they're filed on the docket, and life goes on, and Fair Labor Standard Act cases get settled. And that could happen. But right now, until there's such a requirement in the law, there's not, it's really not my business unless it comes up as a breach of a settlement agreement.
Would you allow Buckley to call these women to testify, given that the MOs seem to be very similar to the other Susie Ann's case?
If we are in that position, it's really up to the defendant at that point to block it. I mean, as a matter, it's not my, but I have to say, you know, we have some of these, remember in some of those tobacco cases, there were, who with the confidential informant, there was a movie about this as well, and the enforcement of that, it's certainly going to be potentially messy. I don't know that I have a per se policy, but about it, but it really depends on the circumstances of the agreement.
We have about 4 minutes till we have to be totally done, and there's several things I want to touch on so we can be really fast through the next little bit. Susie Ann McSweeney is getting cold feet, getting a lot of negative stuff on social media. She doesn't really want to go and testify and embarrass her family, go through all of it again. How do you handle a wavering client? A couple sentences.
Well, the client ultimately is the boss, but if I haven't started to engage in settlement discussions with the company, that's my job. So while we're, assuming we're in litigation, we should be having discussions. I'd certainly do everything I can to leverage the company to come to the table. Certainly, I'd put these three or four Me Too witnesses under subpoena, which is compulsion of law. Compulsion of law overrides any contractual agreement to not disclose any contractual NDA. So I'd let the company know. I'd let them know I'm going to have these people testify. I would have taken their depositions under compulsion of subpoena too. So the unfolding of the evidence is a pressure point. It can be a pressure point for both sides to settle, depending on how the evidence comes out. But I would.
So, Ellen, would you, based on what you've heard in case so far as it plays out, if you were approached by Ed Buckley, would you be willing to settle at this point?
Yes, but I keep it, at this point, that's not our problem. Our problem is that if these other witnesses are credible after investigation, we have a CEO who, in an internal investigation, has lied to us. So we're going to be fired. Our priorities are going to be about the enterprise, and that's probably going to mean he's leaving.
So.
And he's leaving, and we're settling.
Ellen and Karen, kind of feels to me that both of you, and we touched on this earlier, are in lose-lose positions in scenarios like this. You're either going to get hammered by the harasser by not having his back, or the court of public opinion will look at the pair of you as part of the system of failure at Biggles Aviation. What are your options where you can maintain your integrity and professional credibility?
I'll speak first. I will have chosen, yes, to tender my resignation. That's probably the best path forward.
But I think you're assuming that the board is sitting there is saying, we're happy to have him continue like a Steve Wiener and Matt Lauer, and they're not. So actually, if you're working for an enterprise that is saying, we don't want to be part of this, we understand there are going to be consequences for stock price, but you know, board members lend their reputations to companies, and they don't want their names on this any more than Karen and I do. If our investigation was flawed and we have a really dark scenario, he's got to go. We've got to make it right with this woman and any other out there, and get the company back in another day. So I actually think we're going to have a great time being part of the solution.
Judge Totenberg, would you care to poll the jury by show of hands and evaluate who might appear to have prevailed in this case? We've got about 200-person jury. So, Judge Totenberg will evaluate. If you will, do you have any instructions for the jury?
Review the totality of the evidence and consider all the instructions of the law. And even if you are, don't rule based on sympathy or bias for either party. And all those who would fine for the plaintiff on her charge of sexual harassment on the company and Mr.
Bigglesworth.
That's typical, two of me. who is it? Please raise your hands. All in favor, who would rule in favor of the plaintiff on her sexual harassment claims. And I only have one room. I know there are other rooms. All those who, I'm going to make it a little easier. All those who feel that they do not have sufficient evidence and need to basically bash their heads against each other for a little longer in discussion and spend another few days in the jury room, which is too hot. Please raise your hands. And all those who would fine for the defendants in this matter. And remember, the standard is a preponderance of the evidence in a civil case, not beyond a reasonable doubt. All those who believe that the plaintiff must show by a preponderance of the evidence the claims. All those who believe that the defendant has not been shown to be liable.
All right. Ellen, I think you're going to be paying out a big settlement here.
But we figured out that a long time ago. So.
Many, many thanks to the friends of the Bar Media Judiciary Conference who agreed to appear as characters in this account. And to this amazing panel for their willingness to take on a topic as sensitive as this one. And candidly, for providing so many insights. So thank you very, very much.
Thank you.
Don't forget, if you want to join the First Amendment Foundation, see Sean, see me, or pick up one of those sheets. Thank you.
And lunches should be available outside. If you could please grab one and come back in, and we'll get started.
I want to stay for the mayor's
He warned me they'd be putting me on the spot.
Yeah.
Yes, it's a dream.
I love the
president.
Oh,
my God. I just
ran out. So I see it now. It's very he warned me that I would be put on the spot. So we get this started.
So
I don't know about that. Oh, she did. I was a pro.
probably better to support you.
Yeah. 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 Ye